Can you still hear me in the back? If not, you have to move up. I'm sorry. There are chairs in the front. There are pews in the front of this church. And you all come down this way, okay? All right, never mind. Okay, so lovely introduction. My mother would be honored and pleased. I'm embarrassed. But what I want to talk to you about is what is a conflict of interest? And that's why I call this an anatomy of a conflict of interest. And in an hour, let's see if we get a better understanding of conflicts of interest and how they can arise in business, and specifically because you all are in an accountancy session, yes. Susan says yes, it's accountancy and not organizational behavior. What are the kinds of conflicts of interest that accountants can encounter that you may see or experience yourself? If I move fast enough, and I don't guarantee I will, we'll try to look at different ways or different lenses to look at conflicts of interest. So there's a couple of different ways of thinking about them. And a couple of my examples will be very UN specific, and a few won't be. So I want you to see how conflicts of interest can emerge in specific organizations, but also more generally in any organization. Okay? Are you all with me so far? Okay, ground rule. In all of my classes, don't wait till the end to ask a question. Get your hand up and I'll try to see you, and if not, someone else will tell me over there in the green shirt and we'll get the question. Because I'd rather we deal with what's on your mind now so that we all learn from each other, okay? Any problems so far? None. Let's do it. So, it's the real world, and the real world is messy. A friend, how many of you have friends, asks you to lend her money. Anyone have this ever happened to them? Lots of money. Just until next Friday. And she follows you into the cafe or the coffee shop, loudly repeating her request, promising to tell everyone, Gretchen, I just needed $1,000. You've got it with you, don't you?
No.
But she's my good buddy. Everybody, Gretchen's going to lend me $1,000. Would you applaud and tell her what a great gal she is? Come on, yay, Gretchen! Okay, what have we just done? What kind of problem is this? Peer pressure? How? Yes, okay. Pressured her to do something she doesn't want to do. Visible tough spot. Someone else, what kind of problem is this? What do you think? Whisper it to your friend, okay? Okay, if you figure it out. What kind of problem is this?
She risks losing a friend because of the situation that her friends put her in.
Gretchen, if Gretchen says, oh my God, if I say yes, am I buying a friendship? If I say no, am I losing a friendship? So Gretchen, from her perspective, she's saying, oh my God, what am I going to do? Consequences either way. How about from my perspective? What's happening from my perspective? What do you think?
That you just really want the money and you're kind of pressuring her into getting her to give it to you.
Okay. Am I aware that I am crossing boundaries? Do friends ask friends for $1,000 at a pop? None of my friends have, thank goodness. I've never had to ask anyone for that kind of loan. Anyone ever have that experience? I mean, this is a lot of money. Anybody? How about family members? Yeah, often. Who's ever been asked by a family member to lend them some money? Other than my stepson, who wanted $20,000 recently, which I had to say no thank you to. But when we ask for money, whose interests are we pursuing? Mine. When I ask Gretchen for money, whose interests is she thinking about? Hers and consequences. And there is now a conflict of interests between us because I've said, I have tried to manipulate Gretchen into doing what she really doesn't want to do, right? Does she really want to lend me $1,000 until Friday? No, she doesn't have it. And even if she had it, would she be willing to do this?
No.
Probably not.
Why not?
Because $1,000 is quite a bit of money to lend a friend at a moment's notice.
$1,000 is a lot of money to lend a friend at a moment's notice. Don't everyone open up your pocketbooks right now, but I guarantee, or I almost guarantee, that none of us have a spare $1,000 bill just hanging out in the back pocket. It just doesn't happen in our society. And if it does, don't tell me, because I'm going to tell you to get to the bank fast, because that's not a good use of your money. Now, is this a conflict of interest? Yeah. What makes it a conflict of interest? Yes. Urgency, yes. Good indicia of what is a conflict of interest. What else? What are some of the factors that make conflicts of interest, that make them messy? What do you think?
If two people have different opinions.
Two people have different opinions or different goals they want to serve. Anything else makes it, yes.
Possible consequences?
Yes, consequences and possible and real, yes. Yes, it's hard to decide, was there an absolute right or absolute wrong answer here? Because no matter what we do, as soon as I go public with Gretchen is this generous person, and you all go, huzzah, 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 yay, Gretchen, I can't now tell her, oh, I changed my mind, I never really asked you. Gretchen, you didn't understand me, you misinterpreted me.
Thank goodness.
But I can't do that if I've already gone public with it, right? So all of a sudden, consequences, urgency, no right or wrong, obvious answer, two different perspectives, two different sets of motivation. Almost always those are the indicia, the red flags that you're looking at a conflict of interest. Now, why do conflicts of interest matter to accountants? Let's talk about some of the ways that conflicts of interest arise in business. Okay? Have we talked about accuracy of books and records?
They've been learning about that.
Yeah, this
is a...
Exactly. If you're responsible for the accuracy of books and records, and you kind of shade some numbers, you know you're not supposed to do this. But could that be a signal of a conflict of interest? How? Yes?
One of the higher-ups is paying off of the company card, and you don't want to charge it to him because that's your boss.
Exactly. I see some suspicious transactions on the company credit card. They're being charged to, give me a casino. Huh?
Bellagio.
Is Bellagio around here? Do we have casinos in Illinois?
No, that's in Vegas.
Okay, Vegas. Okay, so a lot in Bellagio? Is that it? It shows you how much I go to Las Vegas. So you're asked as the accountant to pay the bills, and you get the American Express card, and there's a lot of charges by the exec to a casino in Las Vegas. You want to make your books accurate. What do you do? Exactly. Charge it anyway, pay it, maybe misrepresent the books. It really wasn't Las Vegas. It was a vendor whose name is Villaggio, and they're based in Moline, Iowa. Moline, Iowa? I'm not sure. Decatur, Illinois. That's better. Okay. So I could manipulate the books. How about arm's length transactions? Anyone give me an example of an arm's length transaction? What's an arm's length transaction and what's its opposite, a non-arm's length transaction?
I will give them an example.
Okay.
They've actually seen it, they just didn't have it labeled that way.
Okay.
between one company and a completely unrelated company, or you could also have a loan between the company and one of the key employees, for example, the CEO. And we've seen loans to employees a couple of times on our books.
Okay.
So those would be two examples. The first is an arm's length transaction, and the second is not.
Exactly. Gretchen, I need a prop. Can you stand up? Give arm's length transactions. Just fingertip only. Can I influence Gretchen at this length if I can barely touch her? Now, less than arm's length, thank you, my dear. And I had to do that, so I surprised her. I can tip her over because all of a sudden I'm not at arm's length. I get close and I tip the balance. Conflicts of interest. Prohibitions against self-dealing? No, you can't sell to yourself and change the books. Prohibitions against loans to executives. Examination of how key personnel are investing and where their assets and liabilities are so that your key executive is not taking a loan from a major part of your supply chain. Nepotism and favoritism. Can someone give me an example of that? Nepotism and favoritism. I need someone to volunteer to be my child. You want to be my child?
Sure.
Okay, I have two kids. Okay, stand up. I want kids here. Okay, you are my children. I have such beautiful, wonderful children. I'm the executive. And I'm going to make my son here. What's your name?
William.
William, my head of HR. He's 18 years old. And you are?
Jessica.
Jessica, my darling daughter Jessica, who is 19 years old. I am going to make my chief of sales. Neither one has graduated college. We are a publicly traded company. Thank you very much. You are great children. You are a compliment to your parents. Is there a problem with this? Help me understand the problem. Blue t-shirt right here. What's the problem here? What kind of conflict is this? No, you can't get help. This is the exam. They're related to me, yes.
So that makes them, you obviously favor them because they are a part of your family.
I'm favoring them. They're my kids. Of course I love them. I think they're fabulous. They're my kids. I'm the mom, right? I'm the tiger mom. No, I'm not. I'm not a mom at all. But, yeah, I want them. Now, what's wrong with hiring your children? Yes.
Not objective?
Yes, in my case, they're not actually qualified at all for these positions. And how many of the rest of you in this room want to apply for the jobs in my company? Don't you all want to work for me? I'm a great boss. I really am. I'll give you my employees' names and they'll tell you this. No, they won't. But, you know, all the rest of you who want to work for my company, what have I now done if I favor my kids? Yes, I've passed up all other opportunities to find the best talent. And as the CEO, what is my primary duty in a publicly traded company? Do what's best for the shareholders, for my investors, for my owners, for my employees. And if I hire these two darling individuals who aren't qualified, what have I done? I've put my interests, because I love my kids, above those of everyone else's interests. Gifts, reciprocity are also ways in which conflicts of interest enter into everyday business transactions in which you are going to see. So, what do we do? Step one, conflicts of interest, there's a three-partite test. Recognize, appreciate, and resolve. Recognize what kind of problem is it? Big, small relationships. Appreciate consequences, harm, benefits. Resolve, what do I do about it? Recognize, appreciate, resolve. If you can use this methodology in these kinds of situations, you're more than likely going to see conflicts of interest and figure out what to do about them. And that's what the name of the game is. Conflicts of interest, unresolved, are wrong. Conflicts of interest that you work on and try to recognize, appreciate, and resolve, that's human life. That's everyday life. So, recognize, appreciate, resolve. Let's start with this case. Your spouse, pretend right now you have a spouse, has been nominated to serve as the president of a non-governmental organization whose mission it is to reduce honor killings in your region of the globe, to provide dowries for young girls, and to reduce incidents of harassment and bullying. You strongly support these causes. You encourage your spouse to meet with your own employees to create awareness, to raise funds, and to mobilize their political and civic networks to help your spouse's cause. Should you also encourage your spouse to contact local businesses, how about your company's vendors? Okay, here's the problem. Turn to someone you're sitting next to. Use recognize, appreciate, and resolve, and see if you can identify if there are any conflicts of interest here, big, small, consequences, and what you should do about it. So talk to someone sitting next to you. If you really don't like the person sitting next to you, you have to move. Or if you're not sitting next to anybody, the two of you do have to move so you can work together. Okay? Ethics is a contact sport. You don't do this by yourself. Ready, set, recognize, appreciate, resolve. Let's see how you tackle this problem. Okay? Okay, give you a little taste of why ethics is so much fun and why I adore what I get to do. Who wants to start and talk about recognizing? What kind of problem is this? I saw a hand. Speak up. Correct. The question was a factual question. Please clarify. Are you and your spouse on the same side? Yes, you both really support these causes. Okay, recognize. First step. Anybody. What kind of problem is this? What is happening in this case? Who wants to tell me about this case? Gentleman, gray t-shirt, gray sweat, gray hoodie, right in the front. What's happening here?
I get, you have to analyze whether or not it's ethical to contact local businesses.
So you, what you're saying, you're being tentative, you're not very clear. So what I think you're saying is maybe this is a problem about contacting local businesses.
Yes, that's what I meant.
Okay, that's what I thought, that's what you meant. Yeah. It's okay. Yes, ma'am. So there's a problem about people getting married. We don't want, in ethics, we don't want people to get married, right?
Well, not that they're married. It's just when you're married to someone, sometimes you agree and you have a partnership, so you kind of have that kind of bond that, I'll kind of manipulate my husband into thinking in a certain way.
I will manipulate my husband, Dr. Craig Packard, into believing anything he doesn't want to believe.
No, but...
Give me the secret. There's a joint interest. If this is a marriage, and we all want people to be happy in their relationships, and marriage is a pretty good thing to have, I really want my spouse to succeed, and I often share interests. So is that a problem that I want to support my spouse in his or her activities? No, I'm being a good spouse. I'm being a good wife. Where does the conflict show up, though? Yes.
Maybe in, because it says you're encouraging your spouse to meet with your own employees and are like raising funds, and they might not have the same viewpoints as you and your spouse, and tapping into their political and civic networks. And
so do I cross a border between supporting my spouse and then talking to my employees, all of you wonderful employees, about why you should also support my spouse's cause? Is that the problem? Is it the marketing and promotion of my husband's interests? Or is it the marketing and promotion of my husband's interests with another group of employees who depend upon me because I'm the boss? Which is it, A or B? B. So I can go with my husband to market and promote his cause, but I just can't talk about it to my employees? Why would I not want my employees to know about what's important to me? Yes?
I guess they may be pressured into putting the cause because they may be worried that you would retaliate against them for not supporting them.
Yes! It's the famous arm twist, right? You know? If I don't do what the boss wants, maybe I won't get my paycheck, promotion, raise. Right? So am I, as the boss, am I in a position to promote something beyond what my business or my organization supports? Can I never talk about things that are important to me? That's probably too absolute. But I do have to be very cautious about the appearance of pressure. Okay, recognize. Appreciate, is this a big or a small problem? I'm going to go up this aisle because I've been over in that aisle for a while. Is this a big problem or a small problem? What do you think?
Small
problem.
Yeah.
Why is it a small problem?
Because it's just between the spouse. It's not really international or anything like that.
It's not international. It's not big politics. It's just at home. And it's just a small office that I work for. So we can probably ignore this and say, don't worry about it. Is your advice to me, don't worry about this, this is a small problem, or is it a big problem? What do you think? Big or small?
I think it's neither.
Neither. Okay, what kind of problem is it?
It's like in between, I guess.
It's in between. Okay, we have a diplomat here. This is good. We like, you know, the middle ground is often the one that you want to take. Appreciate, what are the consequences if I go ahead and do this? Say it again?
Employees will get upset.
Employees get upset. What else? If I do this once and say, and what would happen if I said to all my employees, I want you to donate money to my favorite presidential candidate. I want each of you to tithe 50% of your salary to my candidate for office that's backing. So do you see how if I take one step here, it may be easier to blend these roles and confuse them going forward? Yes, ma'am. Exactly. You're absolutely right. This is a fine example of slippery slope. And when you use recognize, appreciate, resolve, the three-step part that we're looking at, you do start to go down that slope. Susan.
So my question actually relates exactly to this. I agree with the slippery slope characterization, but let's say that I do work at a very small office, and I know my employees very well, and I happen to know that they actually share in my belief. Mm-hmm. Related to this cause. Is it now a problem?
What do we think? I only have 5 employees. We know each other really well. And I know you also respect me as your boss, or at least I hope you do. And you share my beliefs that these are important causes. Is this still something that we should do in the structure of the workplace with the presumed authority that I have as the boss? Yes.
I think it's definitely less of a problem just because when you're defining conflict of interest, it was two parties having different opinions, but in this case, it seems like everyone's sharing the same opinion. Therefore, the problem is strong.
Yes, another. Correct, correct, yes. So a part of the nuance is how I, the boss, present it. Yes, one more comment. I saw another hand, yes? Exactly. If I know we are all of the same mind, a small, cozy group, perhaps I don't pass the bucket, but I say, hey, my spouse this weekend nominated, great cause, everybody. If you're interested, here's the website. And then we talk about something else we have to do. It's just idle chatter. But as soon as I start crossing the line, then are my own antenna, my own sense of rights and wrongs at the workplace attuned to the political campaign or other issues that I might raise? I'll show you how we teach this in the UN. So in the UN, I will say that all of you are UNers, and I teach this in the classes I teach at the UN. And I say, your spouse. Is there anything ethically wrong with having a spouse? No, it's okay. You can have a spouse. My spouse has been nominated to serve as the president of an NGO. Is that okay? Yes, we want employed spouses. Spouses should be employed. They help offset the fact that for the UN, you're never going to get rich. The mission is to reduce honor killings in your region, provide dowries, and to reduce bullying and harassment. Great mission, UN women. That's what UN women, a UN agency, does. So this is fabulous that my spouse is on the same side. I strongly support these causes. I, as the boss, it's okay to have strong opinions about things. I encourage my spouse to come to my workplace and promote the cause. And this is where UN staff get really itchy. Because our role, our work, isn't to hear pitches from spouses. Our role is to do our work. And we also get very itchy when someone else comes to us to try to raise funds from us. As a UN staff member, our focus is on promoting the UN, not everyone else's entity or NGO. Yes. The raising chocolates for the sports team, the Girl Scout cookies. What else do we do? It used to be gift wrap. In Maryland, every school district sold gift wrap. I still have a closet of gift wrap that I bought from the kids who came up and down the street. Okay, I'll tell you a true story. And it's exactly the one I was going to use before we move on. I am working at an unnamed, unknown high-tech engineering company called the MITRE Corporation. And one of the executives, he was the CFO, took his granddaughter's Girl Scout cookie form, it's about yay big, blew it up to poster size on the big reproducing Xerox machines, posted that on the door to his office, took a pencil with a long chain to it, tacked it to the office, and put in the left-hand column where the buyer is the names of everyone who worked for him. I can't make it up. Conflicts of interest all over, but it's the same. It's, can we sell Girl Scout cookies, you know, the band trip, employee to employee, peer to peer? I'm not going to try to regulate that or have concerns about that. But as soon as I add hierarchy, boss, position, I put your names up. When I put your name up, as George did in this case, it means the only thing he didn't do was tell me how many boxes of cookies I had to buy. But when I knocked on his door to talk to George and I saw my name on that door, what's the message? Buy. Buy lots of cookies. And because everyone's name is up there, whoever wants to curry or buy favor with George, the CFO, adds lots of boxes. How many boxes of Girl Scout cookies can you eat? Don't answer that. They're not single servings, you ladies. They're not, no, a package of Thin Mints is not a single serving, as we used to joke about. So there is all of a sudden a coercion from authority, power, and circumstance. Okay. So recognize, appreciate, resolve. In the UN, we stop at raise funds and we say this is absolutely not appropriate. And of course, I would never give my vendors list, my supply chain list, which is confidential information, to my spouse for him or her to try to promote the cause. Now I have really crossed borders or boundaries between my personal and my professional capacity. So, recognize, appreciate, resolve. Let's do another one. Recognize, appreciate, resolve. You are the personal assistant to the executive director of a major nonprofit, a UN agency. Your good friend is the personal assistant for the host country representative. So the host UN agencies are in all parts of the globe, and generally there is a person in the local or national government who represents the host government. We can't go into a country unless we are invited. So we are always guests in the world. My PA, I am a PA, and my good friend is the PA for the host country representative. We have lunch together. We take our kids out on outings. And over lunch, I mentioned that my son must find an internship or he won't be able to graduate. My friend's husband works with the Ministry of Education, and she offers to ask her husband to help my son. Then she asks me about a disagreement that my agency is having with the host country. And I know that this situation is sensitive and a major decision is pending. What do I do? Anybody? What should I do? What kind of problem is this? What do you see here? What kind of problem? Yes?
I'm guessing a problem of influence.
Okay, a problem of influence. Who's influencing whom?
You, quote unquote, is influencing your friend by answering their question of what do you think that they should do.
Okay, so I'm trying to influence. I'm the PA for the UN, and my friend Susan over here works for the host government. And we're chatting over lunch. Is this okay so far? Mm-hmm. Can I have lunch? Can I have lunch with a friend? Can I have a lunch with a friend of a host country? Of course, there's not a problem. And I say, you know, my son really needs to get an internship because he's got to graduate and it's really important. And I know where her husband works. He works with the Ministry of Education of the government. Am I okay at this point by talking to my friend about what my son needs, knowing where her husband works? Everyone tell me, raise your hand if you think it's okay so far. Raise your hands. Am I okay? Am I on good, solid ground so far? Those hands are kind of tentative. Who says it's not okay so far? Those hands. Okay, so someone who raised their hand and saying it was okay so far. Who was that? Anybody? I want a spokesperson. You're my spokesperson. Would you mind standing up? Would you please? Now, who says it's really not a good idea? I'm on thin ice. Would you mind standing up? Okay, and I want to hear the voices. You're going to have to talk loud. I'm the only one with a mic. You're the kid. You've got to be quiet this time. She's the friend. She's got to be quiet. I'm sorry. Okay, why am I okay at this point? Hey, Susan, my son William really needs a job, and I know an intern, and I know your husband works for the Ministry of Education. That's all we've said so far. Why is it okay so far? Have I even asked her for help yet?
No.
I've just said I got a problem. So it may be okay. Other side.
Because the husband, you know that they're in a position of that kind of power, why would you specifically ask that person for help? Because if you're asking them for help, they're probably going to look for something from you, especially if you're disagreeing on something.
But she's my best friend in this country. And our kids go out for picnics every weekend, and they go to the swim club together, and, you know, they hang out a lot. You know, I'm over in her kitchen all the time, and she's over in my kitchen all the time, too. Why would I not tell her about stuff in my life?
You could, but it's like a leading question.
Ah, so I'm anticipating, I'm leading. So you'd say, at this point, what do I do? Do I tell Susan I can never have lunch with her again?
No,
that's what's okay, I can have lunch, but what should I do? So I shouldn't bring up this topic. Anybody else? Yes.
I mean, you can bring up the topic, but simply clarify that you're not looking for any help from her.
I don't want any help, Susan. I don't want you to do anything. I just want you to be a sympathetic ear.
Yeah.
Is this okay?
I would think so.
You think so? How about my naysayers? Is it okay if I tell her don't do anything but just listen to me? Maybe it's okay. We're not so sure. One more comment. Yes. Okay, if I read in between the lines, then what do I see?
Well, like if I was a head honcho of something and my friend tells me that her kid, you know, is trying to look for an internship in my company, I mean, why would you tell me that at all?
Okay.
In between the lines, like I understand even if she stated, I'm not looking for any help or anything, well, okay, why do you think that's important for me to know?
So you're saying, Susan, be suspicious. Look this gift horse in the mouth. Don't trust your best friend. But you're saying, you know, that these are the ties that bind us. So Susan, before I even ask for help, says, Charlie, my husband would be glad to help. Now what do we have? And we're getting to a conflict of interest. We're getting a little, what? Urgent, divergent interests, roles are being confused, personal and professional, asking for favors or something unusual beyond the norm. And once Susan offers and I say that would be great, what does Susan do? Hey, can you tell me about this other piece of information? I know there's a dispute, a business problem between host country and UN agency. She turns the tables on me, and what now must I think about? So Susan says, great, husband will help. So both me and Susan and I ignore conflicts of interest. I ask and she offers. We cross that boundary that you told me to be careful about. And then she says, I need a favor. Tell me about this other dispute that we all know our bosses are involved with. What has happened now? What's the problem?
You feel like you have to help her out because, you know, she's about to do a big favor for you.
Yes. And in the business world, that word is reciprocity. The expectation that we will scratch each other's back. And that's exactly the kind of conflict of interest this is, because now Susan does a personal favor for me, and the expectation is that I will provide a leak of confidential information favor for her. Do you see how the slippery slope has grown? When we recognize and appreciate and resolve, the problem gets worse. So, is this a real life situation? Does this happen in the real world? Yes, it does. Because it is very hard for humans to distinguish between my personal and my professional capacity. We make friends. We create strong colleagues. But we have to be very careful where those lines are, because we cannot permit ourselves to create these webs of reciprocity. Okay. So, another way of looking at conflicts of interest. What is your role? In these cases, I've described what your role is, who you are and what you do. You can also then ask, what is it you're considering doing? What are you thinking about doing? How does this other activity, hey Susan, I need a favor, compare with my regular duties as the personal assistant to the head of this agency? Ask yourself, to whom are you loyal? To whom is my counterpart, Susan, loyal? Where are those obligations? Then whose interests come first? Whose interests am I serving? Will this activity reflect badly on my employer, Susan's employer? Because those are typically to whom our loyalties lie. And will this activity breach any laws, rules, or regulations? Is it illegal, immoral, or fattening? So another way of drilling into the anatomy of a conflict of interest, recognize, appreciate, resolve, and then do a more detailed analysis, asking questions about facts, roles, relationships, duties, loyalties, obligations, and laws. And for those of you who took Business 101, this decision-making model is very similar to the one that you looked at in Business 101. Or 193? There's the 199, yes. I don't have your curriculum in my mind quite yet, but this facts, issues, regulations, duties, loyalties, consequences, options. In the case with my son needs an internship, what should I do? I've asked, she's offered, she asks, now what do I do? What do I do with this situation? You can't stop the luncheon and call me. Okay? I'm not going to pick up the phone and tell you the right answer. What do you do at this point? Are you still with me? What's the problem you're solving? First, yes. So when can I use my private and personal network, all of the hundreds of people on LinkedIn that I'm have connected, our Facebook friends, are those professional or personal relationships or contacts? And I have to think about that before I put them up there. My Facebook friends are probably family and friends. I don't use Facebook, in fact, because in my role, I don't have a private persona. I am only a representative of the Secretary General of the UN. I'm his chief ethics officer. I really don't have a private life unrelated to that role because I'm so connected to that role. So I personally cannot say to Susan, old buddy, my son needs a loan. He's in Memphis. Can you help him? I can't go to Gretchen and say, hey, Gretchen, give me $1,000. Because these are colleagues, but they're developed through my professional relationships. My girlfriend, Kathy, who I adore, who's my dance buddy, and I've known for 30-something years, we went to the same high school, and she went to high school with my cousins. I've never been in business with Kathy, and we ask for relationships and ideas constantly. But I keep a very strong separation. I keep, as we say in my world, clear blue water between those groups of individuals. When you start out in a profession, the separation is not so distinct. But as you become leaders and managers, executives in your own right, you're going to have to make these kinds of distinctions. Like George, don't put the Girl Scout cookie list on the front door of your office. These are terribly difficult and complex questions to think about. So I want to solve this one. What do we do? I'll go back one slide. What do I do? I've asked, Susan says yes, she asks. What do I do? I can't do this, Susan. You know it's not appropriate. What is Susan likely to say at this point? Yes.
I can't talk to my husband because it's not appropriate.
I'm not going to talk to my husband because it's not appropriate. You don't give me some information, I'm not going to help you out. Yes, sir.
I think that depending on whether or not you were friends before you had the job or how long you know her, how much trust you have, there's a certain amount of information you could possibly share that would make it acceptable.
Oh, I can tell you a little bit, but not everything.
Well, she doesn't have to know that you don't have to say everything. But
oh, I can share you with a little bit. So do I start giving her something to say thank you for helping my son out?
A little bit, I think.
You think so? A little bit of sharing of confidential information is okay.
It's a trustworthy friend, and you've known each other for years.
So a little bit of leaking is okay. Yes, sir. So maybe I have to extricate myself from this really messy situation. So one voice is, I'm sorry, Susan, I can't. One voice says, sure, I'll be glad to give you some information, but I really know it's not very important, but it makes her feel good. I'm shading this a little bit. I know I am. One says, you know, maybe I have to backpedal a lot and help my son out. Susan, what do you think should happen?
Yes.
of go back to the son thing and try to clarify without necessarily being totally direct and say, oh, I made a mistake. I wasn't trying to ask you. I'd say, you know, I'm just trying to come up with some ideas of where we might go. Some of the places he might apply for an internship, but come back because I might try to clarify to help my friend understand and subtly and quietly and expect my friend understands me and trusts me and knows, oh, we've just come to work.
So Susan rewinds the film and changes this as a script.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, the resolution. Remember, recognize, appreciate, resolve. We're at resolve. Resolve is tough because sometimes you can't rewind. So I've got a few strategies for managing conflicts of interest, the resolution step. There is a handout that Susan will get to everybody somehow or other, in which I go into further discussion of how the resolution strategies can help you. And it's something we use in the UN. I didn't modify it for all people, so it's a very UN document, but it works. So you really have six major options when you resolve conflicts of interest. Disclose, talk about it, restrict my behavior, recruit someone else to be engaged in the decision, remove myself from the decision, relinquish all authority about the decision, or resign. And these are your major positions. Disclose, restrict, recruit, remove, relinquish, resign. And for those of you who want the slides, you'll also get the slides later. Let's now apply the resolution strategy to one more case. The dinner party. You attend regular monthly dinner parties with seven prominent community leaders hosted by rotation. Each month, a different person serves as host. These are purely informal opportunities to discuss issues of mutual interest. They allow you to take the pulse of the private sector in the region of the globe in which you are working. One member of the group has been indicted for corruption. The case is public. It is contentious, but has not yet been brought to trial. The community leader, one of the people that you meet with regularly, claims he is the victim of harassment and asks you and other members of that group to intervene with the government on his behalf. Okay? What kind of problem? Recognize, what kind of problem is this? What's happening here? This is the final exam. What's the problem? I'm going to start picking on folk. Yes.
I guess whoever this person is trying to use your relationship at the dinner party in order to try to get some special favor from whatever government.
Yes. My colleague, my business colleague, not my good friend Susan or Gretchen, but my business colleague who I meet with regularly. That's what business people do. One member is indicted for corruption, and he asks his business colleagues to pressure the government to do something about the charges, to intervene, because he believes, of course, he's innocent.
I was just going to say that it kind of is merging like personal relationships with business relationships, and it's kind of like, because this seems like a personal get together, like to get to better know them as a person, but it seems like the person in question is trying to bring in like political and business aspects into that. Even like that's how it started, it seems like he's trying to like turn it more towards the side of business rather than just personal getting to know them.
So we've begun a personal or professional dinner party series. We've been having dinner for 7, 8, 9 months. Every month we know each other. We're getting to know each other. This is how business is done, and there's nothing wrong with it. A member of that group says, also intervene on my behalf. Help me out. I don't want to face a criminal trial for corruption. I don't want to be indicted. I don't want to go to jail. I don't want to lose my business if I am found guilty of corruption. That's the kind of problem it is. It confuses your roles. It confuses relationships. It also, I don't know, they appreciate size, pretty high stakes. Because in this country, people who are found guilty of corruption don't just go to get jail. They are executed. In this country, people found guilty of corruption in business face the death penalty. So the stakes in this country are quite high. Your colleague asked you to intervene, to say something, because he believes this is a show trial, that this is politically motivated and not for any reason of corruption. What do you do? What are your options? Yes. Great question. One of the questions you have to ask is the rule of law solid, open, and fair in this country? Will this be a real trial or a show trial? Will your colleague have the right to be represented by counsel, to present evidence, to present a defense, and be presumed innocent before guilty? That's the minimal standards that we have when we think about criminal law in our country, but not all countries provide those same expectations. So great question. Recognize, appreciate, now resolve. What do you do? Last time I'm going to ask you to talk to a colleague in class. Turn to the person next to you, your nearest and best friend. What are you going to do? You have 60 seconds to solve this problem. Okay? 60 seconds. Okay, what's the resolution? That was 60 seconds goes really fast. And as I said, ethics is a context board. You can't sleep through it. It's stuff that you got to be engaged with because there's nothing more fun than ethical challenges. It's what makes us human. What do you do?
Well, you have to deal with it in a professional manner, and you can't have personal life take it into consideration, so you can't get him out of the situation, but you could encourage him to take it upon himself to fix the problem.
So what do I tell my colleague? I'm encouraging you to fix the problem that you've been indicted for corruption. What do I do? Take it a step further. Anybody else on this side? You're too quiet. Sir, beautiful sweatshirt. I don't know what it stands for. It's beautiful. What are you going to do?
I just say I'll just look into it, but then there's no procedure that you can actually take. Just move on, I guess.
I'll move on and abandon him because there's no procedure I can take, and I could look into it a little bit. And your body language says to me, I don't want to be here. This is uncomfortable. Okay. Help your colleague out. What would you do? How do you resolve this? The three of you are chatting. What did you come up with? I'll be glad to help you and then forget I said anything. Does that pass the red face test? Can I do this and not be embarrassed or blush? It's kind of hard. It's hard for me to say, sure, I'll help you out and then forget that I said I'd do it. I would become very uncomfortable making a promise that I can't live up to. It's an option, but it may not be the best of options, I think is what we're saying. What are you going to do?
I think that it's just completely unprofessional. I don't think I would put my life on the line to save him or bring more corruption into a corruption trial.
Okay, so you would say I have to resign completely and get out of here. I can't help you. I can't be part of the dinner circle. Been nice knowing you.
I mean, you'd be part of the dinner circle. You just don't have to offer your help.
Okay, yes. Susan.
I need to recruit a friend. That's why I'm calling on you.
Okay.
I need some help. Here's this horrible situation I'm facing. This person that I know, I've been having dinner with him like for 8 months. And, you know, he's a nice guy. And he's been arrested on corruption charges, and he wants me to help him. And I don't know what to do, Joan. Please help me.
Okay, so Susan recruits and punts the problem to me, her ethics officer. I got it. Yes. Notice I'm not taking the bait. Yes.
I think you should disclose the problem and find out more facts.
Disclose the problem and find out more facts. To whom should I disclose? The other people in the dinner party. Maybe collectively, all of us have a way of helping this colleague where I don't myself. It's a very good strategy. Susan's is also a good strategy, but I'm not gonna take the bait. Not this time. Anybody else? Any other hands? What are you gonna do? Yes.
If he's asking for help, does that mean that he truly believes he did something that was corrupt, and that's why he's asking to get out of it?
Or he could be, he truly believes he did something wrong and he wants some cover. Or he truly believes he's innocent and he wants help.
But why would he need help if he's innocent? Is this again a corrupt society? Or are we assuming this is like in the U.S.?
It is not in the U.S., and we don't know whether this is a country that truly respects the rule of law or not.
Oh, okay.
So we don't know. No. And there are many countries where they have great respect on the books for the rule of law, but implementation is tough. And that's most developing countries. So the rules sound right. The criminal justice code is right. But in reality, what actually happens may not always be in compliance with what the law says. And that's probably where this case is happening. So any other resolution strategy? Anybody else? One more. This has been, I haven't picked on this side. I'm sorry. Okay, two in, black t-shirt, long sleeves. I'm sorry, I don't know anybody's names. What are you going to do? How do you resolve it?
I mean, there's...
His face is great. His body language is fabulous.
I don't know if there's like one right answer.
Okay, there isn't one right answer. There isn't one right answer. Okay, I've got one more eager hand. We'll take it. Hang on. William, and then let's go on. We have to close out. What do you think?
I think what I do is, if I couldn't figure out any other solutions, what I do is I try to remove myself, because if I stick up for him and I'm wrong and he's lying and he is the person, the corruption, I can't think of the word, or I could... I could just not do it at all. I could just not represent him, and then he could be found not guilty of corruption, and then I'd look like a jerk.
So, damned if I do, damned if I don't. Maybe the only thing I can do is remove myself and stop going to the dinner parties and not help at all. Okay, this is a real case. All of the cases I teach have come to my attention. I can't tell you what the right answer is here, because I don't know the best course of action. I know that disclosure is not going to help, because who am I going to disclose? The government? The prosecutor? This is my colleague. I've had dinner with him 8 times. That doesn't seem to advance it. Could I restrict my future dealings with this individual? Maybe. But I don't know if that solves the problem. Could I recruit others to help? Maybe ask the others in the dinner parties, the other 7 people. Maybe they've got ideas. Maybe they have access to insights that I don't have. Should I remove myself and just say, it's too sticky, I've now been conflicted out, I can't do anything, I have to leave myself? Should I relinquish my role? I'll help you, but I'm not going to go to dinners any longer. Or should I resign and leave the country? Now, none of these are fabulous options. The reality is in the messiness of real life. Remember we started with the loan? Hey, Gretchen, I need $1,000. Real life is messy. Real life is very messy when we get to complex problems like this. The reality is in business, we confuse our roles, professional and personal, all the time. We talk and engage our family, my son, Susan's husband. We expect reciprocity. If you do this for me, I'll do that for you later, because it's a web of relationships. That's what makes business run. But at the same time, by getting engaged in our own community, we do open ourselves up to very tough problems like this. So as I close out, a couple of truisms about conflicts of interest. Conflicts of interest are not wrong in themselves. It is how you manage them that is so important, and for which there are rights and wrongs in terms of management. You have to be able to recognize, appreciate, and resolve the conflicts of interest that come your way. I can't do it for you. It's a skill you have to develop yourself. And not acting is never the right answer. Not doing anything will only make the situation worse. Starting with disclosure, very important. What are the interests? What are the roles? It is your responsibility to ensure that your decisions are not affected by self-interest or private affiliations or the likelihood of personal gain. You can take that responsibility for your own decisions, but I can't take them for Gretchen or Susan or anybody else. And finally, when in doubt, ask for help. As Gretchen said, as an ethicist, we deal with conflicts of interest day in and day out. My office gets 2 to 3 calls a day, 365 days a year, requesting confidential ethics advice from UN staff, all 45,000 of them around the globe. That's around 900 queries a year, day in and day out. And of all those queries, 2/3 at least are in the arena of conflicts of interest. So they're real, they are personal, you can't avoid them, but you can be prepared by understanding the anatomy of a conflict of interest. Thank you all very much. I turn you back over to Susan.